It's time for the Roots and Roots Show with your host, Greg Rashid, bringing you history and music from the Black American diaspora. Greg and his guests' goal is to root the show's information in your psyche, providing you the roots to expand knowledge within your community. Now here's your host, Greg Rashid.
And good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are in the universe. This is Greg Rashid with another edition of the Root and Roots Show, heard by many people at their convenience all over the world on various platforms. Got some new friends now in Brazil that are listening to the program. I want to say hi to those folks there, as well as the folks in Ethiopia that are listening in now. But so many folks, and obviously the folks that listen in every Sunday at 3 p.m. Mountain Time, in Denver on KUHS, denver.com, the station created by the one and only, the legendary Henry Archuleta. I want to say hi to all my friends in the Denver and Colorado, throughout Colorado, and I hope to get back there sometime, hopefully this year. I want to try to get back there to visit this year. But anyway, we're going to have, as always, a great show, and I think a superb show, because I have someone who's been on a couple of times on the show, my buddy. I'm just so happy to have him on. I mean, he is just just someone that everyone should know. Not people who just know Black history and all, or politics, just know, because he is just a Renaissance man. And who I'm talking about is Dr. Clarence Hussein. He is the interim political science professor at the Howard University in Washington, D.C., and also interim chairs, I should say, and has written just a ton of books, has been a negotiator for peace throughout the world, been everywhere, and just an amazing guy that, if you don't know about him, if you haven't read any of his books, please get him. You know, there are so many interviews he's done online. He's been, been in the White House, talking to folks, Obama back when, and just so many folks throughout the world. And I'm just so happy to have you on today, Clarence. How you doing, Clarence?
I'm great. It's great to be back with you.
I'm so happy to have you on here again, and just to talk to you again and talk to you about this new book that you have. And the name of the book is $20 and Change. And it's on City Lights Press. And it's about Harriet Tubman. But more so, not so much about Harriet Tubman. It's about about money, the currency. What, folks in America are dealing with. And I want to know, first of all, because you say this in the preface, tell my listeners how, you took a trip with your son, I guess, 6 years ago. And this is where, I guess, the genesis of this book comes about. So talk a little bit about that.
Okay, so again, thank you for having me. The thinking of beginning to write this book back in 2016, when Jack Lew was the Secretary of Treasury in the Obama administration, announced that there would be changes on the currency, the paper currency, changes in the images. Now, this came about because the law required changes for security reasons and for making the currency more accessible to people who were disabled, particularly people who were either blind or visually challenged. So That opportunity opened up the door for changes on the images, which had all the way up until 2016, in fact, up until now, have essentially been white men. And so the $5 bill was going to be changed on the back. And Martin Luther King, Marian Anderson, a Black opera singer who was discriminated against back in the 30s and 40s, and Eleanor Roosevelt were going to be on the back of the five suffragist women who fought for the right to vote, were going to be on the back of the $10 bill, plus an image of a march that took place in 1913, a very important march. That would help lead to the passage of the 19th Amendment that gave women the right to vote. And then the most notable change was going to be on the $20 bill, where Harriet Tubman was going to replace Andrew Jackson. Now, the plan had been that Jackson would be moved to the back of the bill, so there's still controversy around that, and that's being challenged.
And
So
that, you know,
when this
when I
was
read that in
announced,
your, sorry for a minute, but when I read that in
oh,
the book,
go ahead.
yeah, when I read that in the book, I said, my God, I mean, you know, you're going to have the slave master on the back of the bill. And it reminded me immediately of, you may remember this, when they decided, they being Major League Baseball, decided to allow Negro League players to be inducted in the Hall of Fame. And initially, they were going to put Satchel Paige in, and he was the first one inducted. And they were going to have a
Right.
special wing for the Negro Leaguers. In other words, it was going to be in the back of the museum. And Paige said,
Yes.
"Ain't no way, ain't no way, I'm going in that way. You're going to put me in with
Right.
everyone else, and I ain't going in." And so it just reminds me of the same logic that, okay, you know, we'll let you in, you know, we'll put her on the front, but we got to keep Jackson somewhere in here, so we'll put him on the back. And it also reminds me of something that
Right.
you probably were in D.C. when this happened, but when they finally decided they had the King holiday, Reagan signed a bill that in Virginia, I never forget this. They decided, okay, we'll have the King holiday, but we'll call it King Jackson Davis Lee Day to honor
Right.
Jefferson Davis, Andrew Jackson, and Robert E. Lee. And I don't know if they're still doing that yet. I know they still do it in some places in the South.
I was going to mention that because it's exactly that. So a month and a half ago, we celebrated King's birthday, all over the country, national holiday, but the states get to sort of do their thing around it. So Mississippi and Alabama still celebrate what they call King Lee Day, which is celebrate Martin Luther King and celebrate Robert E. Lee, which you could not find two more opposing individuals in life.
My
But there's still a tendency not to give up on these Confederate and segregationist and white supremacist heroes. And so what it does is it attempts to then reduce the person who's replacing them. And that's, part of what is the deal around having Jackson on the back of this $20 bill, with Harriet Tubman on the front. So there's opposition to that, and so there's efforts to like not make that happen. So when this came about, I've been to really dig into and think about, not only who's Harriet Tubman, and try to get my head around a deep dive into her life, but also who's Andrew Jackson.
Right.
And why he should be removed, regardless of who goes on the front. As you mentioned, not only, was he an enslaver and made his fortune on slave trade, he massacred Native Americans personally. He was a military general, and he ordered attacks on Indian villages and participated and got his hands bloody, killing men, women, and children in these villages and communities. And then when he was president, he pushed through the Indian Removal Act, which was basically the last major legislative obstacle to getting these lands. So he should not be honored, no way, no how. But it's really to the point I wanted to really emphasize in the book, is to celebrate Harriet Tubman's entire life, not
Right.
only her heroics when she rescued people, but what did she do after the Civil War? How did she spend the last 40, 50 years of her life?
Right. That's a key point. That is very important. So that would, you know, but there are some folks out there, because you get into the opposition in the book. I really like how you know, phrase what some people are saying. You're very, you know, very fair with the opposition. But what, you know, what do you say to folks who say, well, you know, why should we even participate in this society by putting our leaders, our heroes on their money? And because, you know, what Harriet Tubman was fighting was basically a capitalistic system with slavery, and why should we just honor her by putting her on money?
So this is a question I thought about because, as you noted, there was opposition. not only conservative opposition, which wanted to keep essentially a white male
Right.
persona on these on the currency, but there's opposition from black people, including black women. Even though the black community overall supported this move, there was opposition because those kind of questions were raised about a exploitation, and that Harriet Tubman, who had been enslaved and had been sold, or at least efforts to sell them by her, fit into this long history of capitalist racism. But and what I tried to do in the book is give voice to people who had some concerns, so that I wouldn't present it as if this was just a kind of easy path. But my response is on that is that one is just not their money; it's kind of our money as well.
Right.
And these images are public spaces. We should think of them as we think of these monuments and we think of these statues. They convey a story, a narrative, and it's a narrative that we should challenge. And so, just as we see not only removing these Confederate statues and monuments to segregationists, we also want to replace them. And we want to give a public face and a public expression to people who really have contributed to society. And so my work on this book and reading deeper into Harriet Tubman's life, I developed a different perspective on her, that not only did she fight for racial justice, end of slavery, speak out for women's rights, the right for women to vote, that overall she was really a fighter for a genuine democracy.
Right.
And if we see her in that light, then she was really someone who the whole country needs to honor, because she advocated a vision of society that was inclusive in ways that the society claims it wants to be.
Most definitely. I mean, definitely that's what she was. How, you said, you're talking about the US, but I look at her, how do you look at her as far as the broader world? In particular, I'm over here in Thailand. How would you describe her to someone in Thailand or someone in Kenya or something who may not even know, who may only know Harriet Tubman based on the movie that came out a couple of years ago, if they even saw that? And I have to say,
Right.
over here, the movie Harriet didn't come over here. I had to look at it on a platform over here because
Oh,
it
okay.
didn't come. It didn't even come over here.
Okay.
So,
Okay.
what would you say to someone to describe Harriet Tubman?
So I say, people really want to know about American history, not black history, not women's history. They really
Right.
want to know about American history. Then there are individuals you need to know and understand, because their contribution and their determination to shape the country really deserves more recognition. And Harriet Tubman was one of these people, born in 1822. When she was born, John Adams and Thomas Jefferson were still alive. The country was not even 50 years old. When she died in 1913, she had lived through a Civil War, Reconstruction, Plessy v. Ferguson. Reagan was 2 years old, right? So her life touched, 3 centuries. And in that time period, what she did consistently was just so outstanding and remarkable. To this very day, she's still getting statues built in her honor. The CIA
Oh,
put a statue of her in front of the CIA, at CIA
yeah,
headquarters. There's only three, and she's one of the three. She was
my goodness.
inducted into the Military Intelligence Hall of Fame. She's had boats and ships named after her, right? So her impact has been wide ranging, even though I think her life has been minimally understood. So you
Definitely.
mentioned that movie, which was not a bad movie, but the movie stopped With her in the middle of the Civil War, she was leading a military raid. That was 1863. She lived to 1913. So, what did she do in the rest of those years? And that's really important for people to understand, how she continued to fight as the circumstances in the country changed.
And that's what makes your book so great, because you add on all of that. And who I'm talking to, if you're just tuning in, listeners, I'm talking to Clarence Hussein, author of the amazing book, and I recommend it to everyone. It's on City Lights Press, $20 and change, Harriet Tubman, An Ongoing Fight for Racial Justice and Democracy. It's just a great book. But yeah, it's a, and it's a shame that we have to go through this now. And, because I can tell you, I don't know if I ever told you this, Clarence, but I have seen, I've put them on Facebook and other platforms. I have seen Confederate flags over here in Thailand.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
Okay.
and what happened? So the fight continues. And in fact, I'm technically a part of a group. I haven't played with them in a while. That is a group of banjo players over here. And I have not really been with them lately because they go to some bars here that have Confederate flags.
Right.
And
So
sometimes
are
the folks.
these,
Hey, go ahead. What are
let
you
me
about
ask
to
you, these are people. Are these people Thais or are these Americans who are over there who have the
say? Yeah,
flags? Do you have a sense of that?
it's a mixture, but mostly Thais. And I have to say this is where our history
Oh, okay.
comes in. A lot of Thais that are into Western, as far as Western, like cowboy history and all of America, they
Right.
think that the Confederate flag is part of that. And they get caught into this whole
Okay.
country and Western thing, and they automatically think, well, that Confederate means that. And then when you talk to them, they
Right.
realize that they, oh, that's not right. They get rid of the stuff usually, but they don't really know. So
Right.
you will see that, and I've told folks, you will see that from time to time over here at a, especially if there's a country and Western group at a fair here or night market,
Right.
you will see that. And they don't, and I have to say this too, I know there's some folks who have it at some of these bars. There are some white expats I know who know what it is.
Right.
And they put it up
Right.
purposely.
Right.
Like some of the folks
Right.
I used to see over here wearing MAGA hats. They know what it's about.
You know what it means. Yep. Yep.
They play that game. But what, I'm glad also in the book you talk about the efforts by Bree Newsome and so many other folks to get rid of the Confederate flag, Confederate statues, and talk a little bit about that as far as in relation to Harriet Tubman, as far as why it's so important to get rid of them.
So as you know, the title of the book is $20 and Change, Harriet Tubman's Ongoing Struggle for Racial Justice and Democracy. And the and change part is important because the argument is while symbolism is critical, it should not be seen as separate from substantive changes that need to happen. And so I think people do understand that link. Because what we saw in 2020 was a upsurge in protests and demonstrations that combined both protests against statues and other memorials to the Confederacy, from flags to honoring Confederate generals and soldiers and Jefferson Davis, who was the president of the Confederacy, with calling for end police killings, calling for reforms in the entire criminal justice system, calling for more equity around health care in the middle of the COVID pandemic. So there's a relationship between the symbol and the substance. And so that's what I was trying to highlight. And this goes all the way back. So the protests against these symbols didn't start in 2020. And some of the elected officials, particularly white ones who jumped on board and want it to be kind of seen as they, jumped in and played the hero. This is what Nikki Haley in South Carolina, when she was governor. She's trying to protect herself. But Black people protested from the moment these statues and flags and things went up. I have a picture of Martin Luther King at a memorial to Jefferson Davis down in Mississippi. And, you know, they were protesting and calling for civil rights, but also, you know, calling out that statue.
Right.
So, you know, Black people have, you know, been on the front line of this, you know, since the beginning. Now, there were limits to what Black people could do because they were in the segregated South and, you know, you could be killed. So people didn't have, you know, mass demonstrations, but people, you know, wrote graffiti on these things. People urinated on these things. And, you know, Black newspapers, you know, editorialized against them. So there was opposition from day one. And so, you know, I just really want to underscore that, you know, people have, you know, people didn't just come to an understanding that these things were racist. White
right.
people maybe did. But Black people knew from, you know, the second the ground was broken to put this thing up that, you know, this was an assault on my community. This is white supremacy at its, you know, most expressive.
You know, and it's so funny as you're saying that. And I'm looking, as I look at your book here, I'm thinking, you know, thinking about the fact that your book is technically one of the ones that people like DeSantis in Florida and the folks in throughout the South want to get rid of, don't want to see. What are you talking? I mean, what, you know, I sit over here in Thailand and I can't believe this actual thing where people actually burning books like yours and not allowing them to be in libraries. And it's just ridiculous. And what do you say, you know, what do you say about that? The fact that, you know, you're trying to show true history, but there are so many folks right now, which I never thought I would see happen in the 21st century, that there are people out there that don't want the history shown. They don't, you know, they want to burn some books. They won't allow a book like yours in a library anywhere or to be sold at a store. And I just find that it just baffles me. I just want you to comment about that.
Well, you know, I tell my students that they should be writing books that Santos wants to burn, right? So, so it's a badge of honor for them to, you know, to put you on that list because it means you're doing something right. And I've had a book that was banned. I didn't know about it until I read it in the newspaper back in 2019 or so. So the American Library Association puts out a list every year of books that are banned or challenged. And it's a growing problem. In 2020, there was something like 273 books that were banned or challenged. 1 year later, that number had jumped over 1,500.
Oh my
So it's
God.
Not a problem that's decreasing. It is a problem that is growing because everywhere from the former president to people like DeSantis and others have latched onto this dynamic because they see it as mobilizing the people they need to get them in power. And so it's not going to go away anytime soon. And, you know, I have friends in Florida who teach at universities, others who teach in, you know, secondary schools, elementary schools. They are basically being intimidated and terrorized.
Man.
They don't know, you know, what's going to happen with their jobs. They're afraid to talk about almost any subject. And the problem is increasing. There's a bill that was passed in the Florida State House the other day, which increases the attack on education in the state. They're now going after the universities. There's a effort to ban real critical race theory. So up to now, they've been sort of, you know, faking it and pretending
right.
it. But, you know, people were teaching critical race theory in law schools and such. They want to ban that to make it illegal under Florida law that you basically can't put those three words in a sentence together.
Oh,
and every state, you know, across the country, other states are looking at this and saying, yeah, we can do the same. So, you know, Santos gets a lot of the attention, But it's across the country at this point. We got dozens of states where these kinds of bills are being proposed. Some are passing, but it's what exactly what you said. This is book burning.
Okay.
It's,
Which
they may
one?
not be the
By the way,
bonfire. Some places it may be.
which one of your books did they ban?
The Hitler's Black Victims.
Oh,
So I didn't get details on it. They had an article in the Washington Post, like, and there are different authors who have had their books banned, tourism and James Baldwin and Clarence Lucey. I was like, what? So I was, ages probably be in the company of people who have been banned, but it's also disturbing because again, it's 2020s, and we're in the stuff that's being written. This is not inflammatory. This is
Oh.
not stuff calling for, the end of the world. But it's challenging white supremacy, Christian nationalism, patriarchy, homophobia, and all of those are seen as dangerous to defend. And what the American Library Association says is, over, 80, 90% of these books are either by LGBTQ issues or by Black and Latino writers.
My goodness. I mean,
They're not banning books by neo-Nazis. They're not banning books
I was
by,
about to ask.
Margaret Thatcher or somebody.
Right. My goodness. I mean, that's amazing. Or Ayn Rand and banning her books. That's amazing.
Right.
I want, I could go on all day talking to you about this book and just all your books in general, but what do you want listeners to get out of your book? The one thing. What would you say to make someone, if they're like listening now saying, well, I don't know if I want to get it or not, I'm thinking, what would you say?
So there are a couple of things. So one, I want people to rethink how we think about Harriet Tubman. She's one of the most best known people in world history. But as I found out in doing this research, I did not know all that she did during the Civil War, from not only being the first woman to lead a military operation. But she was a spy, she was a scout, she was a nurse, she was a cook. Then after that, she committed herself and was, played the role she could in supporting women's rights and suffrage. And unique to Harriet Tubman, she had ties with both the white women who were leading the suffrage movement, people like Susan B. Anthony, but also Black women who, in response to the racism of the suffrage movement in many ways, formed their own organizations. And Harriet Tubman, she understood, what those dynamics were. So she had a foot in both of those. And I would mention through all of this, she had a disability. She was injured when she was a child, when she was enslaved,
Right.
and she was hit in the head, almost died. And she had seizures all of her life, probably some form of epilepsy, is believed. But through all of that, she persevered. So, just learning the lessons of her life, I think, it's really important, and I hope people kind of get that. And then the fact that, she basically, to her last breath, was committed to really trying to make the world better. When she was dying in March 1913, she was on her deathbed. And the march that I mentioned earlier of the big suffrage march in 1913 was coming up. They had wanted Black women initially not to participate, then they wanted Black women to march at the back of the march. Ida B. Wells and Black women from Howard University, others said, we're not doing that. And Harriet Tubman, on her deathbed, sent a message to the women, to the Black women, that says, tell the women to be strong. God will not forsake us. This is on her dying bed,
Wow.
right? So, we cannot do less, right? When that, as we live our lives, the opportunities to make a contribution and make the world better, we have to do that.
You definitely do, and your book really, and all your books really go, go a long way to doing that. And I was just thinking as you were saying this too about fast forwarding to a couple of years ago, the women's movement in America, didn't the same thing happen with what Tamika Mallory, as far as eventually she, and some other black activists, women activists, they weren't allowed to speak at some of these women's marches and basically put in the back again?
I mean, it's a consistent problem. Now, the entire, women's movement is not, racist and white nationalist, but those elements are certainly there and have expressed themselves. And there's a often a culture of, some issues are your issues, these other issues are mine. Whereas if you think in a more intersectional kind of way, then climate change is an issue for Black people. And you know this well more than most people. Issues around nuclear war, were issues for Black people, and all everything we can think of. Right, cross sections, across in different communities, but there's a, there's a tendency often to silo and to get territorial about these issues, and and that's happened in the women's movement, again and again and again.
And that's a shame. But Clarence, I would just want to thank you for coming on today. And if anyone wants to reach you, how can they reach you?
You can go to our university homepage and go to Pell Alliance, and you're able to find my webpage and my email address.
And what's the next book you're going to be writing? Or you're taking a big break now?
It's never kind of really a break. But I'm working on a number of different things. Trying to work on something on my grandma. My grandmother was active in the civil rights movement. She passed away a few years ago. She's 101. But she was, active, right? She's in Bessemer, which is right next to Birmingham. She was on those marches on the Pettus Bridge. She was at that famous meeting where Malcolm X came down and talked to civil rights workers.
Oh man.
She stood up to the Klan. So I'm trying to, gather some stuff and write about her. This is just kind of a personal project, but she was
I'd love
one of
to
these
read that.
unsung heroes, right?
Yeah. I'd love
So trying to get that done and then just work some other things.
Oh, that'll be great. I'm looking forward to reading that and talking to you again about that one. And I forgot to mention today, I guess in DC at least today, which is actually tomorrow, but tomorrow for you, today for me is a Harriet Tubman Day, if I'm not mistaken.
Harriet Tubman Day, we're having a big program. I'm going to be doing something with Harriet Tubman's great 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 grandniece, who she and I have done a couple of programs together over the last couple of years. So we're having a big program here. But there's going to be something up in Auburn next week, and I'm going to go up to that. This is where Harriet Tubman lived after escaping from the South. And then next Friday, there's going to be a demonstration by the American Council of the Blind that I'm going to participate in, and they're going to be out protesting and demonstrating, pushing for make sure that the currency are still on target for being produced, and they don't support Jackson being on the back of the 20 either. So I'm going to be out there with them down at the Treasury Department, and I think across from the White House.
Oh, that's going to be great. I wish I was there to join you with that, but I'm there in spirit. But Clarence, again, thank you so
I know
much.
you are.
Thank you so much for coming on today. Again, the book is $20 and Change, Harriet Tubman in the Ongoing Fight for Racial Justice and Democracy. And the author is my buddy and just a superb human being, Clarence Hassan. I'll be talking to you again, Clarence. Thank you so much for coming on today.
And I bet everybody.
All right, take care. I always enjoy talking to Clarence. Just a great guy. Please get his book. It is just great to learn not only about Harry Tubman, also about the history of currency in the US. A fascinating book. And one thing he mentions in the book, he talks about a song that was done by the last poet in 1970. It's about money. The name of the song is E Pluribus Unum. And I'm going to play that right now on the Root and Roots show.
Selfish desires are burning like fires among those who hoard the gold, as they continue to keep the people asleep and the truth from being told. Racism and greed are keep the people in need from getting what's rightfully theirs. Cheating, stealing, and double dealing as they exploit the people's fears. And now Dow Jones owns the people's homes and all the surrounding land, buying and selling at their humble dwelling in the name of the master plan. Cause paper money is like a bee without honey, with no stinger to back him up. And those who stole the people's gold are definitely corrupt. Credit cards, master charge, legacies of wills, real estate, stocks and bonds on coupon paper bills. And now the U.S. mints on paper prints millions every day, and use the eagle for their symbol, cause it's a bird of prey. And now the laws of peace and the owls of wars are clutched very tightly in the eagle's claws, filled with greed and lust. And on the back of the dollar bill is the words "In God We Trust." But the dollar bill is the only god, and they don't even trust each other. And for a few dollars more, they'd start a war to exploit some brother's mother. Then there's the pyramid that stands by itself, created by black people's knowledge and wealth. And over the pyramid hangs the devil's eye that stole from the truth and created the lie. Now Inuit means an endless amount stolen over the years. And Coepus means a new empire of vampire millionaires. And Novus is a Latin word meaning something new. And Ordo means a way of life chosen by a few. Seclorum is a word that means to take from another. Knowledge, wisdom, and understanding stolen from the brother. A Roman numerals on the base of the pyramid's face tell the date they began to exist, when they established this branch of hell in 1776. Now there are 13 layers of stone on the pyramid alone, an unfinished work of art, for 33 and a third is high as a mason can go without falling apart. 13 stars in the original flag, 13 demons from the devil's bag, 13 berries and 13 leaves, 13 colonies of land-grabbing thieves, 13 owls in the eagle's claws, 67 corporations wage the devil's wars, 13 stripes on the eagle's shield, and these are the symbols on the U.S. seal. Now on the front of the dollar bill, to the right of Washington's head, is a small seal in the shape of a wheel with a secret that's been left unsaid. The symbols in the middle represent the riddle of the scales, the ruler, and the key. The square rule is a symbol from the craft of masonry. The scales represent Libra, the balance of the seventh sign. They also represent the just us, which you and I know is blind. The key unlocks the mysteries of the secrets of the seal, so that only the governed human would know what they reveal. The four words above form the last parts of the secrets of the seal, and tells how they fool the people into thinking paper money was real. Now Thesaur means the treasury, where they store the gold they stole, and Amur means to punish, like the slaves they bought and sold. Then Septent means seven, like a 1776, when the 13 devils gathered to unleash their bag of tricks. Then Sigil means the images they've created to fool the world, like the colors on Old Glory, the flag that they unfurl. Now red's for the color of the Indian man, white's for the devils who stole the land, blue's for the eyes that hypnotize with the tricks and traps they sprung. And even to this very same day, they all speak with forked tongue. And so the power's in the hands of the ruling classes, playing God with the fate of all the masses, so the people don't get any in the land of the plenty, cause E pluribus unum means one out of many.
All right, the last poet, E pluribus unum. I hope you enjoyed that on the Root and Root Show, and I'm going to switch up right now. Concluding the show today for a couple of songs by the amazing, the great. We lost them this week, if you're listening to the show live. Talking about the great saxophone player, the genius himself, Wayne Shorter. We'll play a couple of tunes of his. This one's with his buddy, the pianist, the great Herbie Hancock. This is Aung San Suu Kyi, and that song was dedicated to the former leader of Burma, Myanmar, who is actually now under house arrest in Myanmar. And Myanmar is just there's a civil war going on there right now. It's just tragic, and our prayers are always with the people there struggling. So we're going to play this right now on the Root and Root Show. It's the honor, the great Wayne Shorter. He's with the ancestors now, the greatest of all time, Wayne Shorter. Thank you. And that was the great Wayne Shorter on sax, along with Herbie Hancock on piano. That's from their album from 1991, I think. And that was a Hell Bop Hip Hop. And before that, we did Wayne Shorter playing House of Jade. And then we did Wayne Shorter, again with Herbie Hancock. And that was Aung San Suu Kyi, dedicated to the currently under house arrest political activist Aung San Suu Kyi in Burma, Myanmar, as it's known now. But anyway, on the Root and Root Show, I hope you enjoyed that tribute to Wayne Shorter, who passed earlier in the week. And I do some his music off and on, so I'll be doing some stuff on here with Wayne Shorter. But again, I want to thank everyone for listening in today. Thanks my buddy Clarence Lassane for coming on with his book, talking about his latest book, $20 and Change, talking about Harry Tubman and U.S. currency. From the City Lights Press, please check that out, as well as his other books. So Clarence has a plethora of books, and I always recommend all his books, but I want to throw this one out again. Blacks in the White House. I mean, you have to get that. You have to get it. You know, it's very important. And I should say the Black History of the White House. Get that. That's the name of the book, Black History of the White House. Really check it out. I'm proud to have my copy up here on my, I'm looking at it up on my library right now. But I'm just so happy to have him on. We'll have Clarence on again. And I'm just hoping that you have a great day wherever you are in the world and help someone in need, no matter where you are in your province, in your community, in your apartment, wherever you are, wherever complex, wherever you are, help someone in need. By helping someone, you help yourself. So go in love and go in peace. And you can't help anyone, though, unless you love yourself. So love yourself. Get to know yourself. And then go out in that community and help someone in need. Because we're all in the, you know, the pandemic is technically over, but we still got issues. We'll continue to have issues in the world. We got to lessen those by helping each other, doing what we can. As I was mentioning earlier, there's a civil war in Myanmar going on right now. And as you know, there's wars, conflicts going on, obviously, in the Ukraine, but also in Somalia, in Ethiopia, in Palestine, so many places. And just do what you can to help folks, because we're in this together. This is our world right now. We're all the same, you know, despite our races, despite our religions, our differences, we're all the same when it comes down to everything. And if something does come from the air soon, you know, everyone will be uniting to figure out what that is. And we're not talking about a weather balloon. But anyway, this is Greg Rashid on the Root and Root Show. And if you want to get a hold of me, you can go on Facebook, look for Gregory Rashid. Because I get a lot of people who, you know, say comments to me, offer suggestions for books and guests and music to play. And I always follow through on that. So again, this is Greg Rashid. Go in love and go in peace. We'll see you next time on the Root and Root Show. Take care.
Thanks for tuning in. See you next time. And remember, spread the knowledge, share the power.